Good evening, 158. It's State Representative Christina Sappi. And thank you for joining us for a discussion and update on our forward fly issue down in Southern Chester County. We have a wonderful panel from Penn State and American Mushroom and the Department of Agriculture with us this evening. If you're joining us, chances are very high that you have been impacted by the forward flies residentially or commercially at some point in the past. And so I'm so glad that you're here. I hope that if you have any questions during the presentation tonight that you will feel free to email. We will be monitoring those during the event to repsappy@pahouse.com. And this will be recorded. If you have friends that wanted to be on here that couldn't, we will be able to share that on my website after the event, probably posting up tomorrow. So I'm going to just, let's get going with this and introduce Fred Strathmeyer from the Department of Agriculture, who's going to sort of lead us into the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Sappi. Really a pleasure to be with you all here tonight. I'd like to also thank Penn State University and their commitment to this issue that I certainly got involved with about 4 or 5 years ago. I want to thank AMI for their involvement with the growers. It's been a really great public-private relationship. Didn't start out that way, a little rocky in the beginning. But we're in 2023, and the work that has happened between the growers and the university has just been nothing short of incredible. Again, the other piece that I would like to also put out there is just thanking the community. You know, when you started this process, there was a lot of finger pointing and a lot of discontent. The reason I bring that up is that you guys stuck to it. The group that has been doing this for the last 4 or 5 years are individuals in your community that have taken it upon themselves to band together to attempt to find a solution. What better way than to, instead of pointing fingers, than to try to find solutions. And so it's been our pleasure here at the Department of Agriculture to have been able to help in the funding of these projects over the years. We continue to do that to this day. With that, I will lead into and allow Blair Siegfried to talk to you. He's the Associate Dean for Research and Graduate Education and the Director of the PA Agricultural Experiment Station. So, Blair.
Thank you, Fred. It is a real pleasure for me to be able to participate in this evening's session. As an entomologist, this topic is one that's particularly interesting to me. I don't often get to hear or talk about insects, so it's a real pleasure for me to be part of this. I think this program is one that really highlights the success of our research programs that involve mushrooms here at Penn State. I've been back in Pennsylvania about 2 years now, and it's certainly one of the programs that we identify as a program that we're proud of, and one that I think documents our commitment to solving issues associated with our stakeholders and our mission. And I think especially the work on these forward flies highlights the commitment that we have to solve pressing issues that our stakeholders deal with. And a great example of how our research really spans a continuum of discovery to impact. And I think the work that is going on in Dr. Wolfen's lab really shows that commitment and documents some of the successes that we're seeing with addressing a significant and serious problem associated with our industry. I'll just highlight some of the accomplishments that I see as being very important and documenting the success of this program. We are currently at about $750 million in funded research to support this project. I think that represents very significant commitment on the part of a lot of different organizations to address this problem. One of the things that I found really interesting is the fact that only 4 years ago, there were no registered products for forward flight control on the market. And over that relatively short period of time, there are now three products registered for forward flight control. Having a little bit of experience with pesticide registrations, I know those things don't happen quickly. And I think it really illustrates how much effort has gone into this project. I think the other aspect of this program that's really important is it's not only relying on chemical pesticides for control, but there's clearly some documented tools being developed that don't rely solely on pesticides for control. The attract and kill technology that's been developed by Michael's lab has shown some very significant impacts, and I think the adoption rates, even though it seems to be less than half, that's a tremendous growth period over a relatively short time. And I think that it represents a commitment to integrated pest management of this fly as well. And some of the other technologies that are developing involving biological control, some of the efforts that are going into identifying volatiles that affect the fly's behavior, using appropriate wavelengths, all these things go together. And I think what will eventually evolve is an integrated approach to managing the flies that really is effective for the long term and keeps these populations in check. And avoid some of the problems that we're currently seeing. So I really applaud the efforts. I appreciate the support that the state has given, and look forward to lots of big things coming along from this work. And I am grateful that Penn State is involved, and appreciate the support of the mushroom industry, and look forward to hearing more about the mushroom flies as a fellow entomologist. And with that, I want to turn it over to Mike Maziuk, who's the Assistant Director for Horticultural Programs for Penn State Extension.
Thank you, Blair.
Excuse me, I'm going to just put in real quick. I'm so sorry, Mike. I got the email wrong for the questions, and it's repsappy@pahouse.net, not pahouse.com. Thank you. I'm so sorry. Just wanted to get that correct.
No problem. Thank you, Blair, and thank you, Representative Sappy, for providing this opportunity to share an update on the efforts that have been undertaken to address this serious issue of forward flies. One of Penn State Extension's roles is to help the public and businesses make informed decisions using research-based information. In this case, the informed decision is how to deal with forward flies, both in the mushroom production facilities as well as off the farm. And this is where we've been able to utilize that information and distribute it to the public so they can make informed decisions, as well as to the growing industry. So I'd like to use this opportunity to highlight some of the Penn State mushroom fly research and extension team's activities since the last public update. The mushroom fly and research extension team has hosted 11 forward fly action council meetings to communicate the team's progress. The minutes from these meetings can be found on the Forward Fly Community Facebook group page. The team is continually monitoring this page and regularly interacts with community members through the Facebook page. They've also maintained a mushroom fly hotline to interact directly with stakeholders. And turning towards the industry, they've hosted two pesticide credit meetings in the fall and the spring, reaching 127 mushroom growers. And at both of these meetings, growers were updated on forward fly management practices. Every other week, a team member visits mushroom farms to monitor forward fly pressure, the practices, and to monitor how the experiments are going. So it's an active research program. Another venue that they've used is printed fact sheets to educate the public about forward flies. Fact sheets were prepared in both English and Spanish languages and distributed through 24 Chester County townships, 3 libraries, 4 boroughs, and 3 community-based organizations. On the present time, there's a new fact sheet being developed for each of the new three techniques that will be shared with tonight that the team is developing, as well as a fourth one that shows how forward fly life cycle interacts with the mushroom growing cycle. The mushroom fly research and extension team also focuses on applied research projects, and the results generated from their research projects is directly translated into information the growers can use. And I found this fact amazing that in the past year, 45% of the growing rooms in Chester County are using the technologies or techniques developed by mushroom fly research team. I know in other fields it takes a lot longer to go from the bench to the practice, especially like in the medical field, but this is amazing that 45%, almost half, have adopted these practices. The grower input is essential, and they are an active part of the research project and give constant feedback, and it wouldn't happen without them. So we'd like to thank the industry. At this point, I'd like to introduce Rachel Roberts. Rachel is the president of the American Mushroom Institute.
Thanks, Fred. Likewise, I'm really grateful to have this opportunity to address the community that we all live in and love as well. We have been dealing with the forward fly issue for decades. It's not new, and it's really something that continues to evolve as a challenge. And in asking for help from Penn State and in asking for help from residents who can advocate their own issues with forward flies and really make it clear, this is what you get. You get Christina Sappi hosting this webinar and us coming together to talk about, the big challenges here. We know that it's a difficult problem for residents. It's just, we sit in on township meetings. We are not happy with forwards either. As Dr. Wufon will make very clear, they're not good for crops, right? They're, they can cause losses. They take a lot of time and energy to deal with. But we want to do that work, and we want to partner with Penn State in that work. So I was just doing some back of the napkin math, and the industry is spending at least $5 million a year just here in Chester County on forward fly prevention and mitigation. So every time, Dr. Wolfen comes up with something new, or there's a new strategy, or the weather causes more challenges or fewer challenges, they're really addressing that in real time and sharing information to try to make it less impactful on residents and try to make it less impactful on crops as well. So our main strategy at this point as an industry is to support Penn State and all the work it does. And you'll hear from Mike Wolfen. Also on this is Maria Gorgo. She's really helping to do outreach to the Spanish language farms, which is critical for this kind of project to be successful. And our history of support with Penn State goes back. I mean, this industry has a mushroom research endowment. One of our larger growers gives research grants every year directly to researchers. Where we have an opportunity, we sign letters of support to say, yes, we want USDA, we want anybody to give money so that this problem can be solved. And we have to, at that point, step back. We are not entomologists. We want the experts to be dealing with this and trust their expertise. And we also don't want to be angling as an industry to do anything that would compromise the good research and the great relationship that Penn State has developed with the residents. So we're open. Our door is open. At the same time, we want to make sure that we're not interfering with the work by, having any, undue pressure as an industry. We really want to be partners and let Penn State do the great work that it has been doing. With what Penn State is developing, we talk about feasibility, labor, you know, how many people does it take to do this? And can we really, and Dr. Wolfen and Maria Gorgo have just been amazing at understanding that these solutions need to be practical so that people really will adopt them. And it really has been working. So most of the kudos here to Penn State, to Christina Sappi's office for partnering with us on this and for, you know, bringing us in and also, you know, telling us how we can do better, how we can help, how we can be involved in outreach. It's not easy. This is a competitive industry. So we help where we can, but we also want to make sure that, as you know, endorsing Penn State's work is the most promising best practice on the forward issue altogether. So with that, I want to introduce Dr. Mike Wolfen from Penn State, and I know everybody's going to be really impressed with his presentation, and we're just very, very excited about his work.
Okay, thank you, Rachel. Let's see, let me get this presentation rolling here. I appreciate everybody who has come to this event, all the speakers before me, as well as everybody in the audience. It's been, you know, immeasurable the impact of that you as residents have on my research program, and essentially getting it started and getting the awareness to this issue. I know you wish you didn't have to do that. I know you wish that the flies weren't a problem, but it is really impressive, as Fred alluded to, that the community has mobilized just everything that's happened here today. All this work wouldn't be here today if that weren't done. So I want to thank everybody, and I want to get into the updates from this year, as we had a really good year this year. And when I say we, I want to especially highlight the mushroom fly research team, and we have a team now. But before I do that, I want to thank everybody who has made the mushroom fly research team possible, all of our funding agencies, the United States Department of Agriculture, the Pennsylvania Department of Agriculture, including the Representative Sappi's office and others. Also, the Georgie Mushroom Competitive Grants Program, as Rachel alluded to. And yes, you are seeing this correctly. I have applied and received funding from NASA to fund a student to work in the lab. So if there's a funding agency, I'm going to try to get money from them to bring awareness to this problem. I especially want to thank the American Mushroom Institute for liaising with the growers, helping introduce to new growers, and for their support. I think it brought a lot of credibility to my program when I was just starting out that American Mushrooms backed us up. But really, none of this work would be done without the growers. Here are the growers that have been consistently working with me, and I will show you data specifically from their farms here today. Without these growers, again, we would get no research. All of my field trials are done incorporating the growers in on the process, so we know what is feasible, as Rachel said, because if I'm designing something in the lab and a grower can't use it, then it's a waste of all of our times. So if you see these growers, see these trucks, these are the ones to thank. There are more, I'm sure, but these are the ones that have been consistently working with us, as well as the companies who are providing the different pesticides and other things for us to test. But I do want to talk a little bit about the mushroom fly research team. For years, I was really the only full-time person working on mushroom flies. And now we have a much larger team, introducing Jason Wolcott, who is our lab sort of a support technician. He provides and maintains the research colony of mushroom flies. So we have flies year round for us to perform experiments on it to try to figure out better and more effective ways to kill these flies. My research technicians are Hannah Martin and Tyler Lesko. Hannah was an undergrad with me, and since she graduated, she's been maintaining research. She 100%, almost 100% of her time is spent testing new pesticides and figuring out how and if it will kill a mushroom forage fly. Tyler Lesko is doing some really innovative work on biopesticides, naturally plant-derived biopesticides. We'll talk about that a little bit later. Malachi Brott and Luke Reynolds are my graduate students. And you can see Malachi is at the microscope camera in this picture. They are looking at natural enemies of mushroom forward flies, and they've pioneered a lot of great work. They've dedicated tons and tons of hours under the microscope. And then I've had some really fantastic undergraduate research assistants as well. They've all spent lots and lots of their hours learning about research, learning about practical agricultural research. And I'm really excited to have them. I'm always recruiting more students. But now I'd like to get into the sort of the star of the show is the mushroom forward fly. Because this is a public presentation, I always like to provide a little bit of background information. So this is what a mushroom forward fly looks like in sort of a cartoon. And this is what you all see it as, is these little specks on your fly papers that are on your windows. The mushroom forward fly is a specialist, meaning it only eats actively growing mushroom mycelia. There is nothing else in the world that these mushroom fly larvae can eat. They can't eat raw compost. They can't eat dirt. They can't eat dead mushroom mycelia. The only thing they can eat is actively growing mushroom mycelia, and we've tested that extensively in our lab as well. But what that means is the flies are not reproducing in your homes. They're essentially just going there to die. I know that you see them mating on your windows and on your roofs and stuff like that. They can mate, they can lay an egg, but the larvae will not survive because they have nothing to eat. The larvae will die with less than an hour if an egg is laid. They're not living in your drains or yard, again, unless there's actively growing mushroom mycelia there. And mushroom mycelia are like the roots of the mushroom. The adult fly lifespan is only 4 or 5 days, which seems crazy and horrifying, right? Because what that means is every 4 or 5 days, the adults are dying. So you've got new invasions coming into your house every single day. It's not the same flies that's hanging around from June, July, August, September, October, November, December. You're getting a new crop of thousands of flies in your homes every day. And that's sort of why an exterminator can't necessarily help, because an exterminator might be able to kill all of the flies you have on a given day, but there is nothing that I am aware of that an exterminator can do to kill, to prevent the flies from coming in or to kill them as they come in. The fly life cycle is typically between 18 and 26 days on the farms, depending on their growing practices and temperatures. We know they're attracted to light. We know they're most active during dawn and dusk. We know they like to go up, which is why they're most commonly found on your second floors and your attics. They're prone to desiccation, meaning they're prone to drying out if they're not in a humid area. They're attracted to humidity, which is why you find them mostly in your second floor bathrooms. And they're being blown into your neighborhood by the wind. They don't want to be there either. They want to be on the mushroom farms. And I'll kind of show a little bit about that in a couple of slides. But most importantly, they do not sting, they do not bite, and they do not vector disease. And that's the most important part, that they are not a threat to your health. But this is no small problem. And I like showing a little bit of math here to show how this is not a small problem, because one female fly can lay 50 eggs. So if there's one growing room in March that has one female that laid her eggs, in April there will be 50 flies in that growing room. In May there will be about 1,200. In June there will be about 30,000. In July there will be about 780, around 800,000. And then the numbers start to get crazy, 19 million, 488 million, we're in the trillions now. So you can see that very quickly it can get out of hand. From one female in March, that can turn to 305 trillion flies in November if they're laying all of their eggs. So killing one fly in March, what this means is that you're actually preventing 305 trillion eggs from being laid in November. And of course, March, as you felt this year, we had a very mild winter. Winter did not kill off all of our flies this year. So I think the numbers were starting at much higher. Probably they were starting much higher than 200 flies per room either. But you can see how the numbers just can balloon out of proportion this exponential growth can just be out of control. There's no way a grower can kill this many flies in just one room. And we're talking about one room here. Mushroom farms are made up of multiple growing rooms and multiple blocks of multiple growing rooms. So here is a Google Images photo of what a mushroom farm can look like. And each of these little individual roofs here is a mushroom growing room. And this is happening in every single room. So you can see how the numbers can get out of control. And what you're seeing in your homes is sort of like a leakage coming from these farms, where you're only experiencing a very small number of flies entering your homes compared to what's actually on the farms. They're the ones that are blown into your neighborhoods and then can't find their way back to the mushroom farms. There's been over 180 reported neighborhoods experiencing these invasions, encompassing a 242 square mile area. So thank you for reporting these. I'm monitoring them. Every call I get, I check to make sure that the neighborhood is on the map. And we're monitoring to see how it goes up or down with our methods. The top question that I get from the residents is, what is being done about this problem? And I want to state that our goal is to develop strategies to sustainably and safely kill mushroom forage flies. Sustainably meaning I want it to, it's not a one-time thing. I want growers to be able to do it every time, whenever they need to, sustainably and reproducibly over and over again. And safety, I don't want the products that the growers use to endanger the workers. That's a really big deal to me too. Back in 2012, the product diazinon was deemed dangerous, and that's why the forage flies have ballooned up in recent years, is because the products that were being used are deemed unsafe. So we're looking at the safest alternatives as well, safest interventions as well. So we're looking at it four different ways. We're looking at improving fly monitoring. We're looking at doing pesticide screening. We're looking at natural enemies, that includes nematodes, as well as predatory mites. And all of the progress I'm about to show you has all been made in the last year. And this is really, really exciting. This is what happens when we have a team. Let's talk about fly monitoring first. As I mentioned, the numbers balloon out of control very quickly. And it would be difficult for a grower to notice a small number of flies in a growing room just by eye. And it used to be that growers would wait until there would be a lot of flies to start to do something. They didn't have necessarily a monitoring trap or a monitoring program to notice when the flies first showed up, even in small numbers, and to start doing something about it very quickly. So our idea was, what can we do to improve and standardize the monitoring on these farms so they can act quicker? The first question we asked is, what is color light is most attractive to the flies? We did this, we set up an arena where we put a bunch of flies in there. On one side, we put a light, on the other side was darkness. And we would just observe what happens when we turn the light on when the flies are in the arena. We did this with multiple different colors of light, and we recorded how the flies moved when the light turned on. Did they quickly run over to the light? Did they not move at all? Did they go away? These are the kinds of questions we answered. So I'll show you the data now. In the center here are the different colors of light we tested: UVB, blue, yellow, green, and orange. And we recorded their average chain of position. Where did they go when the lights were turned on? The bars on this graph here are going to indicate if they went left, it was away from the light. And if they went to the right, it was towards the light. And you'll see that the UVB light, which was around 295 nanometers, was the most attractive to the flies. More often, the flies went directly towards the light when it was turned on, when the light was UVB. This work was done by Hannah Martin, as well as Dimitri and Fatima. And this work is really, really good. We're happy with it. And the second question was, what is the best material to trap the flies with? Growers are using a bunch of different materials on their traps if they have them. Some growers use clear plastic, some growers use white paper, and some growers use yellow paper. And we wanted to figure out, does this matter? Is one material better at attracting the flies than others? This work was done by Hannah and Dimitri as well. So I'll show you the data, but what we did was we set up an arena with a light and sort of a prototype trap made of one of those materials. We put a bunch of flies in there, and after 15 minutes, we wanted to see how many flies, what percentage of the flies were caught by the traps. So on the y-axis over here, you'll see the percent of the flies that were caught by the trap. On the x-axis here, you'll see the different materials that we were testing, as well as not turning the light on, how many flies just wander onto the trap out of random occurrence. And you'll see here that the aluminum foil was the most attractive to the flies, and that kind of makes sense as it is the most shiny. It reflects the light the most. But you can also see that there wasn't that much of a difference between the aluminum foil, especially statistically, there was no difference between aluminum foil and clear plastic. And the clear plastic was also pretty similar to the other materials. The white paper was the least, had the least percent trap catch. But I think in general, statistically there is a difference, they were all pretty close. So the outputs of this study is that the UVB light was the most attractive, and that I think is the most important part here. Aluminum foil was also most attractive, but I don't know if growers are necessarily going to do that. But I think the biggest output here is using grant money, we constructed 104 traps and distributed them across the mushroom industry. So now there are 104 growing rooms that didn't have monitoring traps and didn't have what we deem to be the most effective monitoring traps in their growing rooms that will be monitoring and will be killing the flies, because killing one female in March is so much easier than killing whatever it is, 93 trillion females or flies in November. We've got 34 more traps on order. Those will be delivered shortly. And the growers are very, very happy to receive these traps and start using them. This is something tangible right away they can throw in their houses and they can use to implement to kill the flies more efficiently. Let's talk about insecticide screening. The insecticide screening, we've got two different ways about doing this. As I mentioned earlier, we've got the group that's working on the plant-derived insecticides as well as the traditional insecticides. For the time being, we're going to talk about Hannah and Dimitri's work doing research on traditional insecticides. We tested aerosol insecticides in the lab. On the x-axis here, you'll see the percent of forid adults that were killed immediately after a 1 minute exposure time. So the flies touched the pesticide for 1 minute, and then we monitored to see who was dead. On the x-axis, you'll see how many were dead. On the x-axis, you'll see the different pesticides we've tried. And you'll see that over here, there are about three good candidates, EcoViaCA, D-Force, and Precor 2625 were effective immediately. However, if you take that out to an hour, so it was still the same 1 minute exposure time, we just came back and checked what percent of the flies were dead 1 hour after that 1 minute exposure. The CB80 here jumped up. So it's still EcoViaCA is still effective. CB80, D-Force, and Precor is up to 100% efficacy here too. And that was really exciting. These are the first aerosols that we saw really good control with. I'd like to point out that EcoViaCA is FIFRA 25B exempt, meaning it is a minimum risk pesticide and it can be used on farms and almost wherever immediately. CB80 is also currently registered to be used on farms, as well as Precor 2625. That can be used in homes. And if you do want to use this product, I don't have any recommendations on how to use it, but please follow the pesticide label if this is something that you choose to try in your homes. Also, after conversations with the USDA Office of Pest Management Policy and the EPA, I've learned that this Precor 2625 is also able to be used on farms as a premise spray, but as a premise spray, as being an aerosol, it's probably not feasible for the growers to do. However, I have discussed with the manufacturer about finding a liquid formulation for them to throw in a tank and spray on the sides of their walls. That's something that I'm in conversations with the manufacturer about. I also want to point out that 16 days later, these three products were still really effective. The EcoViaCA was still killing above 40%. The CB80 was killing over 70%. And importantly, this Precor 2625 was still killing 100% of the flies that touched it for 1 minute at a 100% clip. We also did dust insecticides as well. Hannah, again, was the one pioneering these studies. On the x-axis here, you'll see the percent mortality at 1 hour. So the flies contacted the insecticides for 1 minute. They were removed from the insecticide, and then we watched them for 1 hour. Hannah was the one that developed a method in order to do this. It was really, really clever. I don't have time to get into it now. I think I did discuss it in a previous update. And if you'd like more information on that, you can check the previous update. So these data are old, but important for what we're doing now. It's important to the one that we went forward with, this Ecovia WD. You'll recognize the company here. Ecovia WD is a FIFRA 25B exempt product, meaning it's a minimum risk insecticide, and it's approved for immediate use on the farms, as I said earlier about the other one. And it's OMRI certified too, meaning it's organic. So this is the pesticide that we've done a lot of our farm trials with moving forward. We did a field trial of it on one farm, sort of a pilot trial. We developed an attracting kill station on the windows. This is what it looked like. On the x-axis, on the y-axis here, these are the number of dead flies that we collected from an attracting kill station. However, I've removed this top number just to protect the identity of the farm that we did this study at. You can just know that this is a really big number. After a 2 week collection, there were a lot of flies that collected on this attracting kill station. 2 weeks later, there were fewer flies on the attracting kill stations. There were also fewer flies in the mushroom houses. And then by December, because of COVID, we weren't able to get back to the farms until December. But this is not a zero. It was 27 dead mushroom flies on the attract and kill stations. And that's because there were no more mushroom flies on the farm anymore. They had basically been eradicated in almost all of the rooms, or in all of the rooms, basically. The grower said that it had been this way since the last week of October. And as you know, the fly problem only gets worse in the last week of October. So the fact that the flies were basically eradicated from this farm in the last week of October all the way through December and frost, that was really exciting for us. And the residents of nearby this farm also reported reduced fly invasions during this time. So that was great, but that was just on one farm. We wanted to test on multiple different farms using fly monitors. This is a fly monitor that a farm had. You can tell they're not using the right wavelength of light here. This is white light. But we tested this at 17 different farm sites in Southern Chester County. The black dots are the farms using our attract and kill technology. The red dots are the farms that had not yet adopted our attract and kill technology. I can say that all of these red dots here have since been converted to black dots. So you can see here that especially during the peak fly season, the fly numbers are much, much higher in the red farms compared to the black farms. And if we take averages, you can see that there's a huge percent reduction here on the flies using the technology compared to not using the technology. And this works during peak fly season as well. However, there is a limitation on this technology. So here is one of the attract and kill stations, and that it's that they get overwhelmed really easily. And it's that we cannot prevent the flies from entering a growing room. Those flies still can enter a growing room and they can still lay their eggs there. The only thing that this attract and kill station prevents is those flies from leaving the growing room and either getting blown by the wind to your homes or going to another growing room. So even if a farm is doing everything right, they can still get invaded from their neighbors, from neighbor farms that are not using this technology, and then they can get overwhelmed because of regionally high fly populations. So the idea is that we need to develop control methods that control the larvae. However, as Blair pointed out, there are no known pesticides or delivery mechanisms that can control the larvae. In any of the research that I've looked up, I have not found anything. And what's important too is that the larvae are basically protected in the compost during spawn run nothing can be added to the compost then, because that could endanger growing the mushroom. So that's, I think, why a lot of research hadn't been done before this past year on that. But we realized that that's how we're going to get best control here, is if we can figure out a way to kill the larvae before they become adult flies. So that will lead me into my next two topics here. What is being done about the problem? Let's talk about the nematodes first. And Malachi Broad has been the pioneer of this study. He's done some really, really great work. Here's a picture he took of some nematodes under the microscope camera. And I just want to introduce what was known about nematodes when we started this study. A different species of nematode, Feltiae, Cyrenema feltiae, nematodes were used to control other mushroom fly larvae, but they were too big to control forid fly larvae. So they worked on other mushroom flies, but not forids. The reason is forids are too small, and these nematodes could not get into the forids to eat them from within. The nematodes enter the larvae through their breathing holes and their anal openings, and the Cyrenema capercapsiae nematodes, and the Feltiae nematodes are too big to get through there. However, we were approached by a company to try out these new species of nematode, Cyrenema carpocapsiae, because they are smaller and they might be able to control larvae. The manufacturer also suggested that maybe one application would do the trick. And this is all we knew a year ago, or less than a year ago, when we first started these studies. I would say maybe 8 months ago when we first started these studies. And the question we had to ask ourselves is, can the carpocapsiae nematodes kill forid fly larvae? And you can see how small they are. This blue line here is 7/100th of an inch. And these nematodes are not even 7/100th of an inch. So they're really small. They're nearly microscopic. And here's the scale over here. Here is a nematode on a dead larva. However, interestingly, this larva was not killed by the nematode. And I'd like to show a quick video of what a dead larva looks like when it wasn't killed by a nematode. And you'll see why in a minute. You can see this larva has like organs. It's got fat bodies. It's got a bunch of different things in its body that are supposed to be there. And on the next slide, you'll see what it looks like when a larva is killed by nematodes. On the next slide, here we go. So this is a larva that was killed by a Cyrenema carpocapsiae nematode, and you can see all of these little like spaghettis in here. Those are all nematodes sort of squirming around and eating their way through this sort of mummified corpse of a larva. So to answer the question, yes, it does look like these Cyrenema carpocapsiae nematodes can kill the larvae. And that was super exciting. And actually what happened to this larva here is it burst, it exploded with more nematodes, which is fantastic. That's what we want to see. Here's a burst or an exploded nematode. Here's a burst or exploded larva. These black lines are nematodes that are still remaining. And interestingly, here is a nematode that hitched a ride on a larva that was just walking through. Malachi took a super cool picture of this happening. So yes, these nematodes can kill forid larvae. So this larva is probably the next one to get killed. We did studies on this as well. On the y-axis here, you'll see the percent mortality, percent of larvae that were killed in these studies. And on the y-axis here, you'll see the different treatments we had: a control where no nematodes were added, a water where nematodes are watered on. So we wanted to see if increasing the water killed the larvae as well as the nematode treatment that had both water and nematodes. We did this on compost. We added a known number of larvae to the compost. And then after that, we applied the nematodes to the arenas. And you'll see that the nematodes were killing larvae at about a 60% clip, which we were excited because 60% is way higher than anything that we have ever seen before. This has never been done before, killing larvae in compost. So this was super exciting. The nematodes can do it. However, the main problem is that the compost is not the thing that the growers can apply the nematodes to most of the time. Most of the time, they will be applying to the casing material, which is sort of peat moss and other, dirt-like material. But the forage flies do not go into the casing material because there's no food there. And we also know from previous work that the nematodes prefer to be in the casing material and not the compost. So we asked the question, will the nematodes that are applied to the casing infect larvae that are in the compost? Because nematodes kind of walk at random. They slide around moist compost or soil until they find something they can attack. So what we did was we applied casing material on the top with compost on the bottom and a known number of larvae on the bottom. On the y-axis here, you'll see mortality, and on the x-axis, you will see the different treatments, and you'll see that there was only about a 10% loss of efficacy in the nematode treatment. It went from 60 to 50 when applying to the casing, and that was super exciting to me because I was worried that we might lose all of the efficacy because we're applying nematodes in an area where the larvae are not. So I was actually really surprised by this and really excited. This is really good work by Malachi and Justin both. We did a pilot study. The growers were doing what the manufacturer recommended, one application of 1 billion nematodes on the farm. The grower felt like the treatment was working. However, our numbers really didn't support it. And we wanted to revisit this one application recommendation from the manufacturer, which the manufacturer was thrilled about, because we don't think one application is enough. We wanted to ask the question, how long are the nematodes active in the compost and the casing material? So we did what we're calling persistent studies. Malachi and Justin took the lead on this as well. We made we made 10 different arenas. This was repeated 20 times. We added a known number of nematodes to each petri dish, and we developed a procedure to recapture and count living nematodes. To my knowledge, this had also never been done before. And to quote one of the members of our lab that had his doubts about whether or not we could develop a procedure to recapture nematodes, he thought it was a lost cause and we could never do it. So major props to Malachi here for developing a procedure to count living nematodes, because all of the things we found in the literature were counting dead nematodes, to kill the nematodes first and then recapture them. What we did was we broke down these 20 arenas, 20 per day for 9 days. So on day zero, we wanted to see how many we could recapture, day one, day two, day three, et cetera. Malachi was coming in every day to break down these tubes under a microscope, count the number of living nematodes, and compare and to try to figure out what the percent survival is. So on the y-axis here, you'll see the percent survival. On the x-axis, you'll see the number of days. And you can see then that we get about five days worth of more than 50% survival in the compost for these nematodes. And then after that, it drops precipitously to where we think that the nematodes are likely ineffective after five days after application. So what this means is we're recommending to the growers is that one nematode application is not going to cut it, because eggs that hatch here at this time are not affected by the nematodes. And that's what the industry was doing. And a lot of the industry was unhappy that they weren't getting good control from the nematodes. It's because we just simply didn't know enough. A lot of the growers were getting ready to abandon using the nematodes because a lot of them just didn't think it worked. Malachi came up with this farm experiment where we will just apply nematodes every 4 or 5 days after the plastic is pulled, which means the day before casing. So we recommended that the day before they add the casing material to the crop, it is safe to apply things to the mushrooms. So we say apply the nematodes directly to the compost here, and then to the casing material 3 or 4 more times, and then once after the first harvest. So that's what we did. Nematode applications every 4 or 5 days, depending on the schedule of the farm. And it's important to note here, again, feasibility. No additional labor is necessary for these applications. These applications happen to be timed when growers would be watering their mushrooms anyway. So the only additional labor is opening 2 bags of nematodes into the watering apparatus and then watering like normal. So this is fantastic. It's no additional labor it's no additional labor really to water it into the compost. Another thing that we did, that we doubled the application rate. We doubled the number of nematodes being applied to the compost on the first application, on the last application, because we think that's really important. I wasn't going to show this data. We actually just finished analyzing it this morning. It's one growing room from one farm, but it's super exciting. So I'm going to share it with you anyway. Take it with a grain of salt, because we can't draw conclusions from this one room yet. Anything could be going on. We've got 5 different farms here and 20 different growing rooms. So, but because this is the first farm data to come in, I wanted to show it. So on the x-axis here, you'll see the fly counts. The first one is invaders. These are the flies coming in to lay eggs. There's nothing we can do to stop the flies from entering the rooms to lay eggs. What we want to see is a reduced number of flies during case hold and harvest in our nematode rooms, okay? So the invaders will tell us relatively how many flies should we expect, and how does that differ in both case hold and harvest. And to answer the question, it differed a lot. I'm not going to tell you what the number is here, but I will tell you that this number over here maxed out the fly monitors every single day we were expecting invaders. What we see here is about a 60% reduction of flies in this nematode room during case hold, but even more impressively, I think this is like an 80 or 75% reduction of flies in the nematode room compared to the control room. Another interesting thing to point out too is that these growing rooms were right next to each other. And during harvest, the doors are open so the pickers can bring the mushrooms from inside the room to outside of the room. So the doors are open of these neighboring rooms. I think it's entirely possible that flies from this growing room happened to enter this growing room and got trapped on the fly monitor. That's just a hunch. We'll see what the other 20 rooms on the other 5 farms tell us. So the nematode experiment study: do Steiner nema cover capsia nematodes kill mushroom forward fly larvae in the lab? The answer was yes. We were very happy with this 50% number, because we've never even seen like 20% in anything we've tested over the last 4 years. So this 50% number was really good. How long are the nematodes effective? Oh, about 4 or 5 days. And when we applied 4 or 5 days on the mushroom farms, we were pretty excited about the results so far. But again, take it with a grain of salt. We will have all of the rooms will be analyzed hopefully in 2 to 3 weeks, and I'll be able to say something more. I'll release it to the public once we finish analyzing. And this is the first intervention that is effective that targets mushroom fly larvae. Again, this is really exciting. Getting back to it now, let's talk about predatory mites. This work was pioneered, and it was his idea, actually. Luke, he came to me with this idea, or he came to Mike Crossley at the University of Delaware to start using predatory mites on mushroom farms, and I am all for it. And Dimitrios has been helping him out with this project. So let's talk about predatory mites a little bit. What we knew about predatory mites going in is that these mites feed on soil-dwelling insects. They're generalists. They'll basically eat any soil-dwelling insect that they come across. These mites are used in many other crops to control their pests. And the manufacturer thinks that they can be used in mushrooms, except it's possible that the predatory mites may eat or damage the mushroom mycelia and the mushrooms in general. So we've got two questions to answer here before we can bring the predatory mites to the farmers. Number one is, can these mites kill forid larvae? And number two is, do applications damage the mushrooms? Do these mites damage the mushrooms? Again, this work was done largely by Luke, and Dimitri was helping out in this project as well. So we went back to the microscope camera, and we wanted to look at, this is a time-lapse video of do mites attack and kill forid fly larvae? And the answer is yes, pretty voraciously. It didn't take very long. This is, I think, an hour-long video, hour and a half-long video of just mites destroying and eating mushroom fly larvae. So yes, they do. Here's a little GIF that Luke put together of a mite pulling out the internal organs of a dead forid fly, a forid fly that it killed. So these, in Luke's observations as well, the mites will eat almost an entire corpse and sometimes leave just the head. So they are absolutely voracious predators on these things under the microscope camera. Interestingly, these white strands here, they look like spider webs. That's the mushroom mycelia I keep talking about. These are the roots of the mushroom, basically. So we did some predatory mite studies. What we did was we added three mites to compost that contained 10 larvae. And we wanted to see what percent of the larvae will be dead after 3 days. I forgot to mention that in the nematode studies, our studies looked at mortality after 3 days. So in this study, we also looked at mortality after 3 days. So on the y-axis, you'll see percent mortality. On the x-axis here, you'll see treatment. You'll see that we did a control, no mites added, and mites added, three mites added. And you'll see that the mortality is much higher for the mites. It's almost double, actually. I think this is 87% mortality in the mite treatment compared to in the control treatment. And that's super exciting. Again, this is another intervention that growers can use on their farms. We were curious to see how many mites larvae a mite can eat in 3 days. And when we added 20 larvae instead of 10, the three mites killed 83% of them. So not a big drop off. We're really curious because we want to know what kind of dose the farmer should be using on their farms. So we wanted to know how many mites, you know, what is the upper limit here? How many mites does it take to kill, or how many larvae can one mite kill? So now we're going to bump it up so that only one mite is going to be with 20 larvae to see, can one mite kill 20 larvae in 3 days? And I think the data show that these predatory mites are prolific at killing mushroom fly larvae. It took Luke and Dimitri hours and hours and hours combing through mushroom compost, looking for the remains of mushroom fly larvae. In a lot of cases, they didn't find many. In some cases, they would find like just the head or maybe parts of the body. Their careful observations and records really are appreciated by myself. But I appreciate them is what I'm trying to say. So to answer the questions, the final question, do mites damage and eat the mushrooms? Here we collaborated with John Pecchia's lab and the Mushroom Research Center here at Mushroom State. They show, Penn State. They have been studying sort of damage to mushrooms for decades here. And to answer the question, we're working on it. We've developed what's called racing tube assays. And what we do here is on the bottom of this tube, we put some supplemented mushroom compost. We add some mushroom spawn, which is the seed of the mushroom. This is essentially what the mushroom grows out of. And then on top of that, we also add more compost. In some of the treatments, we added six mites, which is a lot of mites. You saw the damage that three mites can do. So we added 6 mites here because we want to be super duper sure whether or not the mites can damage the mushrooms. And then we record the mycelial growth. We want to see how fast and how much growth happens above and below the mushroom spawn, how long it takes and how much growth we see. This is what it looks like. The spawn was, we started these assays last Wednesday, so a week from yesterday. The spawn was applied in this pink band here. You can see a little bit of mycelial growth around here. And we want to see, we're going to let this grow for 2 weeks, as is typical. And we want to see how long it takes or if the mycelia can colonize the compost. We'll have definitive results in 2 weeks. And if the racing tube studies are conclusive, we will run pilot studies this season and probably large field trials next season so that the growers will have these things next season. And I will say that the growers are chomping at the bit to try these predatory mites. As soon as we give them the green light that it won't damage their mushrooms, they're going to be all over it. So for the mite study, do the mites kill the mushroom forward fly larvae in the lab? Yes, they do really, really well. Do the mites harm the crop? To be determined. I'll let you know in 2 to 3 weeks. Feel free to call the mushroom fly hotline. And again, this is the second intervention that targets mushroom fly larvae. Last year, 2 years ago, there were 0. So now the fact that we have 2 is really exciting. Really briefly, let's talk about flavonoids. I want to talk about that what they are. Flavonoids are common plant compounds found in blueberry, grapefruit, wine grapes, and parsley. Plants produce these flavonoids when they're stressed by either insects or disease. Flavonoids help plants fight off insect disease and pressure. And we want to know, can we use flavonoids to control the insects and disease in mushroom farms? This was done in conjunction with Surinder Chopra's lab here at Penn State. Tyler Lesko was a graduate student with Surinder Chopra. I was on his committee, and Trent was an undergrad working on this project as well. And what they did in the Chopra lab was they bred corn. They are plant geneticists breeding corn to produce more flavonoids. And what they did was they ground up the corn plants. These corn plants are supposed to be green. You can see these purple colors. Flavonoids are a natural flavor compound as well as a dye compound to get purple color. They are actually approved as an additive. This can be added to food to make it more purple, so they don't have any human toxicity that I'm aware of. What they did was they ground up this plant material and made chemical extracts of them to see if they kill mushroom flies. Preliminary data done in the Chopra lab, as well as I think in David Byer's lab, was they showed that flavonoids produce dry bubble, which is a mushroom disease. Applying it to the compost killed mushroom disease, and it had no effect on the mushroom yield. So what that means is these compounds can be safely applied to the mushroom compost, and at the very least, they will kill mushroom diseases and not the mushrooms. In my lab, we saw that flavonoids had minimal effect on adults as a residual, meaning to apply them to different structures or mushroom flies just walking on these compounds. We didn't see enough kill where we thought it would be an effective thing to bring to the growers. However, we do know that mushroom flavonoids kill fall armyworm larvae by dissolving their gut, which is super cool. And we're running tests on mushroom fly larvae now to see if the same thing is true for the mushroom fly larvae, just like it is the armyworm larvae. Tyler is spending 100% of his time in my lab. I've employed him as a research technician to answer these questions, as well as the growers asked if they can fog these flavonoids. I'm developing my studies in my lab based on grower feedback, and they want to know if they can fog these flavonoids because it's such a safe product in their mushroom farms, maybe as a knockdown to kill the flies that are already in there. So that's something we're going to test also. Very briefly, I'd like to touch on odor attractants. I get the question from the community all the time, what are they attracted to? And a lot of the time, it's their sense of smell, as well as temperature and differences in relative humidity. But a lot of it has to do with odor. We have developed a specialized glass. We have developed specialized glassware and volatile collection apparatus that can collect volatiles. And volatiles are odors, odorant chemicals, chemicals that that can be smelled. And this apparatus, we can collect the chemical odors that are coming off of things. So here we've got raw compost and spawn compost. We want to see the difference in the odors because we know that flies are not attracted to raw compost, but they are attracted to spawn compost. And we think it has something to do with their sense of smell. So we're just starting this project in collaboration with John Pecchia's lab as well, who is providing us with all of the compost and the lab space that we need in the Mushroom Research Center. It involves some pretty cool analytical chemistry techniques where we use a gas chromatograph as well as electroantennagraphic detection, which is essentially using a severed insect head in an electrical circuit to measure the electricity coming out of their brain, specifically their neurons that they use to smell and detect odors. So we want to be able to answer the question, can mushroom forward flies smell things? And if so, are they attracted to those things? Once we finish this pilot study, we can test anything. We can put anything in these chambers to ask the question, can the insect smell it? Are they attracted to it? That kind of thing. So we're super excited to be able to answer this question as well. That way, if somebody asks, are there products that I can use in my home that maybe repel them? Or is the mulch I'm using attracting them? These are questions that I get from residents all the time. We'll be able to answer this question now. We've just started this also a week ago yesterday, so a week from Wednesday. We'll have the results from these studies, at least preliminary ones. It'll take about 45 days. So hopefully before the winter. Developing a technique with this is probably years away, but it's on the horizon. We have the capability to answer the question now, and it'll be a really good one to answer. Another project that we're doing in collaboration with the University of Delaware, Dr. Michael Crosley, as well as Chandra Kambametu, is incorporating machine learning for fly monitoring. What we're doing is trying to figure out if we can develop an app to take a picture of the now standard fly traps in the mushroom industry, and it'll count the number of forid flies on there, as well as sierid flies, as well as other insects, as well as just garbage that's on there. We've got a really good prototype running. It's not quite yet ready for testing, but we got a grant to study this. Dr. Kambametu is recruiting a grad student to do this, and Michael Crosley has, I think, 7 or 8 undergraduates working on this project as we speak. So progress being made. It's probably a year or two away from introducing it to the farms, but also know that this is being done. So in terms of what I'm calling here a grand summary, the farms now have effective and standardized monitoring protocols to intervene early, because again, it's easier to kill 1 or 200 females in March than it is to kill trillions, hundreds of trillions in November. And every single fly in March, April, May counts exponentially. The attracting kill stations continue to expand to new farms. Growers are using them, and it's really exciting to see fewer flies being able to leave the farms. They're getting killed before they leave the farms and can go somewhere else. However, they do get overwhelmed when the fly populations get too high, and usually that's coming from other farms. There's a bunch of dead flies here, but all of the pesticide has worn off because just, I think the number was like 1.2 million flies was killed by this single attracting kill station on this room on this farm in 24 hours. And there were 2 of these attracting kill stations in this growing room. I estimated this by weight. I didn't count all of the flies by myself. Also excitingly, these nematodes, the standard carpocapsia nematodes, were able to kill forid fly larvae in the lab, and the field studies are promising. I don't want to speak too soon, but I am speaking too soon, and we're really excited to get the results. And one of the things that I'm really excited to get the results by is because of how many scientific studies helped design these material, design these methods, and also the growers helped design the methods so that they are able to use them as soon as we broadcast that this can be ready for use. So it's approved by our experiments, it's approved by the growers. One of the growers from this study says that financially he can't afford not to use this study. We haven't analyzed the data from his farm yet, but he was begging me not to have control rooms on his farm, but we really need the control data in order to compare it to the nematode data. Another grower told me a very similar thing, that he started using these nematodes, he's never ever going back because of how useful they are. We haven't yet introduced them to the larger, we haven't yet introduced the methods that we're first testing to the larger population of growers yet. However, I've got a grower meeting in 2 weeks, and best believe this is what I'm going to be talking about. In 2 weeks, we should have the majority of the data analyzed, and I'll be able to show the growers this is being done on farms in the area. The growers is a small community. They all talk. I'm sure they all already know the effect that the nematodes have on the farms, even though we haven't counted the data yet. Also, the predatory mites were really good at killing the forward fly larvae in the lab. And after these tests, hopefully farm trials are on the horizon. After a week, so I guess after 8 days, it looks like we'll be okay, but it takes a full 2 weeks of testing to know whether or not the mites do in fact damage the mycelia. We're continuing to evaluate new pesticides that might work on mushroom fly adults and larvae. Hannah Martin is, her job is dedicated to getting in new pesticides, testing them a whole bunch of different ways to see if it'll work, and figuring out or passing that information on to me. And then I'm gonna work, and I work with the growers to figure out how can the growers best use this intervention on their farm. Again, I'd like to thank all of the funding agencies that make the mushroom fly research team possible, as well as the, who I forgot to mention here, the Penn State University, who also contributes a significant amount of money towards our program as well. As it was stated by Blair, we've got $750,000 worth of funding over the last couple of years, and that's about to double really quickly to support all of the research that we've been doing. And again, thank AMI, thank the growers that let us try a bunch of stuff on their farms. What I didn't show here is all of the experiments that we did that didn't work. The first, I would say, 2 or 3 years of my work here, everything I tried didn't work. And in fall of 2020 is when we got our first really good results on farms. And once we figured out what we need to be doing, that's how we get really good sustainable results that growers can use. And there have been countless hours spent on experiments that did not work, but we learned something there as well. And I want to thank everybody who has contributed towards the mushroom fly research team as well. A Penn State logo should have gone here, but I forgot to include that. But you're all aware that Penn State has been that we have been working on this project. I would also like to thank Maria Gorgo with her outreach to on the mushroom farms as well as liaising with the Spanish-speaking growers to get more visibility in those communities as well. I'm also recruiting one more person, at least a full-time person, maybe another graduate student, maybe a postdoc to do more studies. And I'm always recruiting more undergrads to join the lab. So with that, I will take any questions. I forgot to put the mushroom forward fly hotline number up here. Since this is being recorded, I'll say it. It's 833-574. I will email it to you. 833-574-6743, I think is the number. So with that, I will take any questions if there are any. I haven't been monitoring whether or not there are questions. And thanks everybody again for attending, and thank the community for bringing awareness to this problem so we as researchers and extension faculty can work hard to solve the problems that there are here.
Thank you so much, Dr. Wolf, and we really appreciate the presentation. It's really mind-blowing. And we're really appreciative of State and all of your students and the industry for their participation, obviously. So we did receive several questions, and I'm going to just quickly go over some of these. But one, and I this is a question for me as well. I love to eat and cook with mushrooms. Do any of these that you've got on your screen right now get into the actual mushroom? And can we be, is there any way we would be ingesting any of this? I think a lot of people.
Yeah, that's a great question. And I got that question as well. That was messaged to me as well. The answer is these are soil dwelling natural enemies. So the nematodes do not leave the soil. When the way the mushrooms are harvested, there's almost no likelihood that that a nematode will make its way onto a mushroom. With the mites, there is really no reason for a mite to be on the mushroom. What they do is in the wild, and we've seen this in our laboratory studies as well, is that the mites go where the food is. So if there's no larvae or no insects in the soil, they just leave. They have no interest in the mushroom, at least in the mushroom fruit, in the things that we eat, they have no interest in that. It's the roots that we're looking at, and we think there's no way that these either of these natural enemies will make its way into the fruit.
That's great news, because as grateful as I am for all the work that these guys are doing, I'm not sure I want them in my mushrooms. Another question is there a way to keep the forward fly out of your home? We're working at the farms, and we're root cause here, which is so important. But is there any way to keep them out of the homes?
Yeah. So I've done a lot of studies. So I'm an insect behaviorist, which I'm sure a lot of people in the audience didn't know that is a job that existed. Mushrooms were fairly new to me in 2017. So for the first two, three years, that was the question I was trying to answer, is why do these mushroom flies go where they're going? How do they get in? And what can we do about it? And I continue to do studies on that, because that really is my passion, is answering the question of why do insects do what they do? But the short answer is, and I said it a couple times in this presentation, if a forward fly wants to get in somewhere, it looks like it's just going to get in somewhere. We have had no success preventing the mushroom flies from getting into the farms. I've done studies in people's homes, blocking certain things, their attics, their soffits, their HVAC systems. We are not able to figure out how to prevent, unfortunately, these flies from getting to where they want to be. But that doesn't mean we're going to stop trying. Just because we've been failing for 5-6 years now, doesn't mean we're going to find what works. We're not going to find what works. So we're working on it, and hopefully the odor experiments that we're doing will give us some insight into that, because even if we as much as we would like to figure out what odors they are attracted to, it'll be equally important to test things that repel them. And maybe it's something that smells nice. I know some of the growers recommend citron oil, that they think the flies might be repelled by that. So we're gonna test that and see if that works, because that's a pleasant smelling odor for our homes. And if it keeps the flies out, that would be great.
Right, thank you. And that's something, obviously the residents that are tuning in tonight to get this update, that's very top of mind for them. So, and they've been patient, so I understand that need to know. should we be mandating the growers to do any of these methods? That was another question.
Oh, man. You know, these methods are so recently established, where we've only recommended to growers in 2020 that everybody should start using these attracting kill stations. So these are still really new to the industry. The nematodes, same thing. We're still counting our field studies. So in terms of the mites, we haven't done any field studies with. So I would be uncomfortable without years of study to mandate something. But what I can do is recommend to all of the growers that they do use it. And I know that Rachel at AMI has recommended that. AMI has given me a fantastic forum to meet with growers, to talk with growers. We do on-farm trainings with growers to show them how to use these technologies. But in terms of a mandate, honestly, I'm also just a scientist, so I don't know anything about mandates or anything like that. I would pass that on to you and Rachel to answer that.
Well, and so that's where I come in, is like, you know, the state could possibly mandate, but you want to do something that's grounded in science and that is effective. It takes a long time to get, you know, the legislative process is not quick. So, you know, it has to get through committees in one chamber and then go to the other chamber and then to the executive chamber. So it's not a quick process. And if you're going to do that, you want to make sure that whatever you're mandating is 100% effective. So I think, and the answer to that question, at least from the state's perspective, is we're not there yet. And it doesn't sound like that it would be actually necessary, given the amount of progress that we're making, doing what we're doing, and the amount of participation we have from the growers. So I think, you know, back to Rachel's earlier point, it's not good for their business either. So everybody's very interested in doing the right thing here. It impacts all of us. So
yeah. And it's interesting to point out, and I didn't say this, that the mushroom forward flies are responsible for between 10 and 40% of the crop. Mushroom farmers lose between 10 and 40% of their crop every year because of mushroom flies. So I don't know if it would even need to be mandated, because if they work, the growers are going to talk about it. The growers, as much as they are competitors, they understand that their neighbor's flies are their flies also.
Exactly.
And eradicating the fly, yeah, is a right. Good thing.
I've seen that too. I mean, they're interested in the industry as a whole. And it's competitive, but they are definitely, you know, allied in their industry. So I appreciate that. And obviously we appreciate the residents who tune into these events to get the update and that care about the science. And they're very, you know, collaborative and appreciative of all the work you're all doing. So again, I am so grateful for Penn State's work here and for all of the assistance and backup from the industry and the Department of Agriculture. I thank you all so much for joining us tonight. Again, this has been taped. This will be up on my website. And if you have any questions that didn't come in tonight, you think of them afterwards, or you may want to watch this again because this was a lot of information, do feel free to call my office and we'll connect you with somebody that can answer your questions. Thanks again. Have a wonderful evening, everyone, and take good care. Bye-bye. Thanks again.